We all know that we got independence in the year 1947, and the Constitution of India was put into operation on the 26th of January 1950. And for this purpose, I would just have my address in the background of three articles in the Constitution, Articles 14, 15, and 16. And as history students, you all might be familiar with these three articles. Article 14 talks about equality to all persons. 15 talks about equality for the citizens, as well as Article 16 for citizens. And you all remember the preamble of the Constitution, which the jurists now describe as the key to the Constitution. Where the founding fathers of the Constitution proclaimed equality of status and of opportunity to all in order to achieve justice, social, economic, and political. Coming to Article 14, you all would remember the article reads like this: the state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. Article 16 relating to public employment, and Article 15 is in general that there shall be no discrimination on the grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth. Now coming to Article 14 again, the right to equality. The state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or equal protection of the laws. What is the big difference between the two? Equality before the law is that before the law, all persons within the territory of India shall be treated equally. Equal protection of the laws carries a different connotation. Law as a protector should always view when it treats the people with equal protection for them. That's this. Actually, this phrase is borrowed from the American Constitution by our founding fathers. Equality before the law may be a legal concept, and equal protection of the laws is obviously a real concept. Now, suppose you believe that all the citizens, all the persons within the territory of India should be treated alike, irrespective of their variations, irrespective of the disparities what they have. Would you think that this would lead to equality? Because people, persons are not all equal. Treating unequal people equally is again inequality. Therefore, when the law aims at equal treatment, it at the same time, by the same breath, says there shall be equal protection of the laws. Just we would take an illustration. For example, there are thousands of viewers sitting in an auditorium or a stadium to watch a particular sport or game. You all would remember that the people who are sitting in the front row would be taking the lowest seat. The people who are sitting next behind will take a slightly better or higher elevated pedestal. Then it will go on like that. The person who would be sitting in the last row will be sitting at the top. If you see, all these people should be treated alike with the perfect. All should be seated alike without elevated platforms. Would all the people, especially the people who are sitting behind, would be able to see actually the people who are playing the games of the sports? May not be possible. Only 1 second. Famila, you are able to hear now? Hello? Famila, you are able to hear now? And this is the simple illustration that the people who are sitting in the front should be allowed to sit in the same row. People who are sitting behind should be given a little higher platforms so that they can also see the sport or the game equally.
this is the background, this is the illustration to emphasize the need for equal protection among the laws. When the people, when the citizens or the persons ought to be treated equally, legally equally is one thing, but really equally is another. That is, somebody who is weak, somebody who is backward should be given some kind of uplift, some kind of promotion, so that at the end they all will be equal. This is the basic concept of Article 14. So the state shall not deny to any person equality before the law or the equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. Now, you see, when we look at the background of this, the historical and the legal background of this reservation, it was sometime in 1948. The 1921 communal GO took a different form in the year 1948, then year next to the year of independence. In 1950, when admissions started for the professional colleges like engineering colleges and medical colleges in the state of Tamil Nadu, the communal GO was put into operation. There were seats reserved for caste-based communities, what we call the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes. Certain number of seats in these colleges were reserved, where all the people could not compete. One Srimadi Shambagam Durairajan, you might have all heard about, she questioned the validity of the communal GO, saying that this is patently running contrary to the concept of equality guaranteed to us as a fundamental right under Article 14, as well as Article 15. Because Article 15 very clearly mandates the state should not take into account caste as the basis for discrimination. The state shall not discriminate on the grounds of religion, caste, race, sex, place of birth, so on and so forth. Therefore, this GO, which is trying to discriminate people by allotting separate compartments for caste-based communities, was running contrary to my fundamental right. That was the argument advanced by Shambagam Durairajan. She filed the case in the Madras High Court. The Madras High Court full bench quashed that GO, saying that this is unconstitutional and running contrary to the constitutional fundamental rights. How they held it was because there is yet another article, Article 13 in the Constitution, which says the state shall not make any law or pass any order which will be contrary to the fundamental rights guaranteed under Part 3 of the Constitution. So the Shambagam Durairajan's argument that this communal GO, which is reserving seats in the medical colleges and engineering colleges on caste based, on the basis of caste, was something contrary to the equality right protected under Articles 14 and 15. High Court of Madras quashed the GO, saying that you can't have such reservations. Then the state actually appealed to the Supreme Court. Supreme Court in the year 1951 said that the judgment of the Madras High Court is right. There can't be such caste-based reservations in medical college admissions and engineering college admissions. That actually perplexed the minds of the entire politicians, because all along their manifesto was that these oppressed classes should be uplifted. Scheduled castes and scheduled tribes who were historically oppressed should be compensated by way of some kind of uplift. That uplift would be possible only when you give some kind of reservation, both in matters of employment as well as in education. Therefore, when the Supreme Court declared this communal GO as unconstitutional, immediately the parliament had to be convened again, and the first amendment to the Constitution of India was brought forth, the very first amendment. A new clause was introduced in Article 15 as clause number 4, which said the state is competent to give some kind of reservations in favor of backward classes of citizens. So by introducing that new clause, the lawmakers got the power to make special provisions for the uplift or for the protection of the rights of the people who are classified as backward classes. And we will see a little later what is the meaning of the term classes, whether it is or it can be assessed or determined with reference to castes or not is another issue. Then by that very first amendment to the Constitution and the introduction of Clause 4 to Article 15, the lawmakers gained the power to make the laws, especially giving protection or reservation for the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in educational institutions run by the government, obviously. By the same time, Article 16 is an article which ensures equality in matters of public employment, that is appointment in government services and in public sector undertakings. There already there is a clause 4 which said that backward classes can be given some kind of reservation, special treatments. So now by introduction of clause 4 in Article 15, a similar clause which is already available in 16 is brought in Article 15. Thereby this power is given to the lawmakers to do such a special things possible for the uplift of the backward classes. And all of you know that backward classes is always identified with reference to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes of those days. And you might know that there are two articles, Article 341 and 342, under which the President of India is empowered to notify which are all the castes that are known as scheduled castes and which are all the tribes which can be known as scheduled tribes. And they are generally understood as backward class people. By the time, there is yet another phase that comes in now. What about the other backward classes? Whether backward classes ought to be understood only with reference to scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, already notified by the President of India under Articles 341 and 342, or there is something else, because Articles 15 and 16 use the expression backward classes, not scheduled castes and scheduled tribes alone, backward classes. Therefore, you all remember it was sometime during the year 1975 to 77, India was under emergency. And after 1977, Indira Gandhi announced public elections and she was defeated, the Congress Party was defeated. Janata Party took the mantle of power and it lasted for only a couple of years. Morarji Desai became the Prime Minister of India. And when he was about to lay down office, in the year 1979, he suddenly thought that I must leave some imprints in the history of India. And he decided to suddenly announce the appointment of one B.P. Mandal, a politician from Bihar, to head a commission, which was famously known as in those days as the Mandal Commission. The task assigned to the commission was to find out, are there other communities, other classes in India than scheduled castes and scheduled tribes which ought to be treated as backward classes. That was the job assigned. And soon thereafter he came out with the reports, two or three reports, classifying or discovering almost 3,700 castes in India as backward classes other than scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. And that 3,700 and odd castes actually constituted 52% of the population of India. And obviously, after the 1979 election, you all remember that Indira Gandhi came to power again, the Congress Party. And they did not want to implement this recommendation of the Mandal Commission report. They just kept it in cold storage. In 1984, Indira Gandhi was assassinated. Rajiv Gandhi took over power and he also did not want to implement the Mandal Commission recommendations. And you may remember the finance minister during Rajiv Gandhi's prime ministership was V.P. Singh. And in the year 1989 or 1990, actually he was shifted from finance ministry to defense ministry. And by the time he wanted to make some inquiries about the defense deals and other things, and famously known as the Bofors issue. When Bofors issue emerged, next time the Congress party again lost power, VP Singh, with the support of the outside support of the communist parties, left-wing communist parties, and the right-wing BJP, became the prime minister next. And by the time he wanted to announce the implementation of the Mandal Commission report, but the problem for him was, he was actually sandwiched in between two extremes. The communist party and the BJP, the right wing and the left wing, which were extending support not by joining the government but by sitting outside. They were external outside supporters. And at the time when VP Singh started announcing this Mandal Commission recommendations to be implemented, the left wing communist people supported, but the right wing BJP opposed it, and eventually they withdrew the support for VP Singh also, and thereby the government collapsed. At the same time, when the announcement of this Mandal Commission recommendation, there was a lot of protest throughout the country against the implementation of the Mandal Commission recommendation, because especially the people of the upper castes felt that this announcement of 27% reservation for the other backward classes, OBC. Thereby, there are now three classes of people who are within the ambit of reservation: scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other backward classes. This 27% for other backward classes, 15% for scheduled castes, 7.5% scheduled tribes, all put together constitute 49.5%. It was a matter of great embarrassment for the people of the higher communities or the upper communities. They felt that the large amount of the share in public employment and educational opportunities would be denied to them. Therefore, there was a lot of hue and cry throughout the country, and even some of the people got self-immolated in Delhi, seeing that one public interest litigant lawyer, Indira Soni, she moved to the Supreme Court challenging the office memorandum by which the VP Singh government announced the implementation of the Mandal Commission recommendation. That was put to challenge before the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court class decided the validity of that in the year 1992 by a large bench of 9 judges of the Supreme Court sitting together in a single court. And ultimately, the Supreme Court said Mandal Commission recommendation recommending for reservation for other backward classes to a level of 27% is constitutionally right. And they found, statistically speaking, the reservation that was provided was only 49.5%. They said, at any rate, all kinds of reservations put together shall never exceed 50%. Third thing they said, this 50% ceiling is on one hand. At the same time, you must periodically ensure that whether these classes which are now brought within the ambit of reservation are really adequately representing the public employment or offices of public nature, both in the government as well as public sector. So there must be adequate representation. Suppose a community has already got adequate representation in public employment, that it shall cease to be under the reservation thereafter. The third thing is, the reservation concept will be available only at the entry level. When a person takes up the employment, for example, take the example of Bishop Heber College, the entry level position for faculty members is assistant professor. At the level of assistant professor, reservation is okay. But when you move on to the next cadre of associate professor or principal, you shall not claim reservation. In short, reservation would be applicable only at the entry level recruitment, not for promotions at all. That's the other thing they said. And this promotion aspect, the parliament thought it fit to make some avenues possible for promotion for scheduled caste and scheduled tribes later. Thereby an amendment was also brought in later. A new clause was introduced again in Article 16. The clause is known as Clause 4, capital A, saying that this, in order to get over this judgment, this parliament made the law and incorporated an amendment into the constitution. Clause 4, capital A, saying that nothing wrong if special provisions are made for reservation in promotions in the case of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. The other thing the Supreme Court talked about in respect of the OBC, other backward classes, is though the classes are identified with reference to castes, still we can't say that all the people of those castes are really deserving reservation, because they may not be backward, all of them may not be backward. So in order to find out those people who are actually well off, educationally and socially well off, in those identified castes, how to take them out from the purview of reservation, Supreme Court coined that expression, the creamy layer. Otherwise, what will happen is, suppose castes form the basis for the classes, there will be always an upper segment in those castes. They will always take the lion's share of all reservations in education and employment. In order to alleviate that, the Supreme Court evolved this concept of creamy layer, not in respect of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes, only in the case of OBCs, saying that the government should find out the people who are forming the creamy layer of those classes, and they shall be rendered as not within the purview of reservation. And obviously, economy became the criterion. People who are economically well off in those castes were to be identified as the creamy layer. Therefore, as I said, in order to provide the provision for promotions in the case of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes in promotions, Clause 4, capital A, came to be introduced. That was by the 77th amendment to the Constitution, which was done in the year 1995. Then that again was put to challenge before the Supreme Court in the famous case, S. Nagaraj versus Union of India, where the Supreme Court said nothing wrong in providing reservation in promotions to the, in the case of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. But one rider was added, namely, while giving reservation not only in initial recruitment but later promotions also, the government should ensure that the efficiency in the administration shall not be the casualty. You must ensure always that efficiency in administration should be maintained in order to provide this reservation in promotions also. This is what Nagaraj said. In Nagarajan's case, the Supreme Court said. Then again, by the time when the Mandal Commission case was argued before the Supreme Court in the year 1992, you all remember that Narasimha Rao became the Prime Minister of India. Narasimha Rao was actually caught in between the two. One is that people who are asking for, demanding a reservation for the other backward classes on the one hand. On the other hand, the upper class communities are fighting that why you always have this social and educational backward. We may belong to upper classes, but we are economically at the downtrodden level. Very weak position. Therefore, why don't you evolve the concept of economic backwardness also? Narasimha Rao wanted to strike a deal. Therefore, what he did was, he gave an amendment to this Mandal Commission office memorandum by adding one more clause saying that this 27% reservation for OBC is okay, 15% for the scheduled castes and 7.5% for scheduled tribes, all okay. That is constituting 49.5%. Apart from this, reservation shall be given to the other communities, the communities which don't fall under the three of these categories, OBC, SC and ST. Communities, classes other than these three, who are economically backward shall be given 10% reservation. This was also considered by the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said this is something wrong constitutionally, and struck off this 10% reservation, which was based on economy, not on social or educational backwardness, but on economic backwardness. The reason given by the Supreme Court was all these articles of 15 and 16 contemplate only social and educational backwardness, not economic backwardness. Therefore, if you want to give 10% reservation on economic grounds, that is unconstitutional. Therefore, that was struck off by the Supreme Court. Why I am emphasizing this is because now, recently, the present central government has brought in a constitutional amendment. That is the 103rd constitutional amendment, bringing out the same thing again. The only difference would be, at the time when Narasimha Rao did it, he actually amended the office memorandum and added one clause. Not a legislation was passed in the parliament, much less a constitutional amendment was brought forth. But now what the present government has done is, it has brought forth a constitutional amendment, bringing out Stalin. Therefore, the present government has brought forth a constitutional amendment, 103rd amendment. And now the matter is before the courts, all of you know that. And it is for the Supreme Court to decide whether economic criterion would be a determining factor for assessing the backwardness of the classes. And this economic backwardness concept is introduced again under two clauses, clause number 6 in both Article 15 as well as in Article 16. 15 for education and 16 for employment. This is the present position now. And it is for the courts to decide whether this economic-based reservation would be constitutionally permissible or not. Now, what I would like to, I feel that because you're all must be familiar with all these things because of students of history department, it is better that we shall have some interaction, because this brief or the broad introduction would be sufficient, I believe. So, you can also ask some questions and I will try to answer those. Namira, you are able to hear now? You are able to hear. Okay, then shall we move on to some introduction? Or on any other aspects you would like to highlight on any other aspect? Pamela, you are able to hear? Therefore, I would say that it's all right, Pamela. You are able to hear? Yes. Therefore, the struggle has a, and one thing I would like to emphasize, that is the, in the long struggle for reservation, the role played by the people of Tamil Nadu is something really significant. Because it was sometime, as you recalled, it was sometime in 1921 the struggle started. And this, even today it is not over. Stage by stage, the pursuit is still going on. The struggle is on again. And very often the politicians do one thing, the courts are trying to reconcile. Then again, amendments are brought in the constitution and laws are made. Now the position of law after the Mandal Commission decision is... Now the position after the Mandal Commission decision is that government is competent to even notify, by way of notifications, the reservation policies can be introduced. Second is, the other backward classes also are entitled for reservation under the Constitution of India. Third is the promotion which is declared as not permissible by the Supreme Court in Mandal Commission is got over by the constitutional amendment by introduction of clause 4 capital A in Article 16. Now promotion is also possible, but not for other backward classes, only for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. And the creamy layer concept is applicable only for the other backward classes. Now the attempt made by the present government is a constitutional amendment enabling them to provide reservation for economically backward people. This is where we stop now. And it is for us to wait and see what the Supreme Court is going to tell on that. Economically backward means the communities other than scheduled caste, scheduled tribe and the OBC. In the moonu category la varadhavangal, that is the so-called upper community people. Avanga economically downtrodden a irundal, avangalukku da and the reservation. That is what the government is trying to do. Correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Then
sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening. I am Anand,
associate professor of this department.
Welcome, sir.
I want to ask one question.
Yeah.
If that economically backward people would have to get the reservation without struggling anything in terms of getting the reservation, we have struggled for more than a century to get the reservation, but without any struggle, they have got the reservation in terms of economically backward, belonging to other than the SC, ST and OBC.
Yes.
Is it justifiable generally or in terms of constitutionality?
As far but as any of the yes, I am. Yes. And you want me to say whether it is justifiable or not, correct? See that you are right in pointing out that so far as this social and educational backward communities are concerned, the struggle for reservation has been very, very long. And not only long, it was very arduous also. And if you look back the historical background of this concept of reservation for social and educationally backward, it is only a reparation, historical reparation. Certain communities in India, because of this ugly caste system, had been kept under oppression and suppression from time immemorial. When we got independence and we proclaimed the constitution with the preamble saying that we shall ensure equality of with the justice, social, economic and political, then these classes which had been suppressed from time immemorial, historically suppressed, they should be given some kind of compensation. That compensation is what we call reservation. Why they need compensation is because of the caste system that was prevalent in this country. Certain castes were prohibited from taking education and taking employment until the constitution was actually announced. And those communities were historically suppressed. They were denied education and employment. Therefore, when the constitution comes, the governments wanted to give some kind of uplift, some kind of boost, some kind of reservation so as to uplift them, so that they can also attain equality with the other people who were suppressing these people age long. Now you are trying to ask me why these people who suppressed these communities should be given 10% reservation. This was primarily the argument of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. I told you in the beginning that the courts, the Madras High Court as well as the Supreme Court, struck down the policy of reservation, the communal GO, in Chambagam Dorairajan's case. When the Parliament wanted to amend the constitution so as to get over Chambalam Durgarajan's judgment. The one of the points that was urged before the parliament was, why don't we provide economic backwardness also, along with the social and educational backwardness? Pandit Nehru vehemently opposed that. And he said categorically, economic backwardness is attributable to the person's lethargy or his willingness to work. It is not always attributable on historic suppressions or oppressions. People were never suppressed in India on economic grounds. On the other hand, people were suppressed and oppressed only on caste orientations, caste-based suppressions. Therefore, when we give reservation, it should be both only on educational and social. Actually, it is social. It is social backwardness. Social backwardness which resulted in educational backwardness. People of India were never in suppression on economic grounds. That is why Nehru was very astute in saying that let us not incorporate economic backwardness as a criterion for assessing the backwardness of the people or for reservation. But anyhow, for the first time in 1992, Narasimha Rao only to appease the people, appease the protesters and the revolters. He said, yes, you take please 10% reservation and that shall be for the communities other than those with my reservation. This again, actually, if you ask me what it will lead to is, at the end, the whole of India will form the reserved class. 49.5% already on social and economic backwardness, educational backwardness, and the remaining 50.5 will be under economy-based reservation. The whole of the India would be under reservation, which is something very, very hard to accept. And secondly, economy can't be the definite criterion for Professor, I think that you are keeping your mic still unmute. Please mute your mic because it is causing some disturbance here. Therefore, this economic criterion is always a criterion which is uncertain, flexible. A person may be rich or poor. Today he may be rich, tomorrow he will be in the streets, as we have been witnessing in the case of business people. Therefore, this can't be the definite criterion for determination of the backwardness, number one. Secondly, if you keep on giving reservation for people who are economically backward, then there will be a tendency to always remain economically backward so as to fall within the trappings of these determining factors so that you will enjoy reservation. Thirdly, the founding fathers of the Constitution, some 70 or 75 years ago, they were completely conversant with the historical background of the nation. Because all of you know, India is not a nation of a single ethnic group or a single creed or single linguistic group. It is a conglomeration of multitude of people with varying languages, with varying religions. And historians have gone on record that at the time when India got independence, the population was around 50 crores. It was never a homogeneous group. It was such a widely variegated heterogeneous group. 8,400 castes and subcastes at that point of time. 1,600 minor languages and dialects. That was the diversity of the population. That's why if you read Ramachandra Guha's book, India After Gandhi, I believe that first chapter is devoted under the caption, Nation Unnatural. Because a nation would be normally understood with reference to their ethnicity or religion or language or their culture. Here it's a conglomeration of everything. India contained a world itself. In such a situation, the politicians of those days, our leaders, they took a historic decision to live as a single nation under a single constitution, ensuring equality to all. That was a very, very bold measure they took. Why? Because they had adequate and sufficient knowledge about the history of the people, about the history of the country. More than 800 and odd nations put together formed India. they had sufficient knowledge about all those things. That is why they were very careful in using the expressions social and educational backwardness. Social backwardness in reality, which resulted in educational backwardness. And Nehru completely rejected the idea of adding economic backwardness. Narasimha Rao added and failed it before the Supreme Court. Now, legally, these people, the present government has brought in this amendment saying that Narasimha Rao failed because he did not bring forth any constitutional amendment, but we are here to bring a constitutional amendment. Therefore, it has got the constitutional backing. Anyway, it is for the Supreme Court to decide. But personally speaking, this is the evolution of a new concept which was historically unknown. And if economy is going to be the factor for reservation, that will never end. As long as human beings are there, there will be a class which will be called economically backward. If one segment of the population grows, the other segment of the population will deliberately remain backward economically in order to enjoy the provisions of reservation. That is my view. Okay.
Students, guys, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
You can ask.
Good evening, sir. I'm Kokila Bardi from second year BA history, sir. So my question is, reservation oda negative impacts pathi solla mudiyuma sir? Then ipo merit la vanda poravangalukku inda reservation la edhaavadhu affect aaguma adha mari
solla? Yes, surely. This is the debate all along. See, meritocracy is one thing, democracy is another. Meritocracy means that then again you must look at what are the scales or what are the yardsticks or parameters upon which you assess merit. Is it the mark merit what you get in the examinations, or your physical competence, or your ability to understand and reproduce? There are various factors to determine merit, but the safest system what we have now is some kind of examination, you know, either examinations written or examinations by way of interview. Where what is put to test? I would say that only the memory is put to test, not other competence. Then still, why we accept this system? Because this system is less arbitrary, less possibility of abuse, because something is on record. There is a written examination or a recorded interview, where the abuse or the arbitrariness would be least. That is why, though the system is not pakka or perfect, but above all, this is the least misusable system. And only thing that is the memory is put to test. Suppose you ask a person to swim across the lake, that most meritorious student who is topping the list may not be in a position to jump into the lake and swim. If you ask him to climb a tree, he may not be. Therefore, he doesn't have other talents at all, except the memory power. He reads books, memorizes, and vomits them out in the answer sheet. And we award marks, and merit is assessed only in this pattern. Can we say that this is all that is to be talked about merit? No. This is the system we follow in order to ensure that this is the least possible of any abuse. And there, I remember I read a book written by one Dr. Chandrasekhar from Bangalore. It was under the caption, Merit My Foot. He says that the system of merit what you have in vogue is my foot. It is not at all the assessment of the correct merit at all. This is the system what the British had in those days for getting the best clerks, the Indian clerks, to be employed for them. And we find that this is the system which is least misusable. Therefore, we have been following that. And if you say that a particular community which has been denied employment and education for centuries together, if you read the Mandal Commission judgment, there is one reference about a newspaper clipping of the year 1941, a community called Vannar in Tirunelveli, which was prohibited from getting out of the huts during the sun. As long as the sun is there, that community is prohibited from getting out of the hut. They were called the Vannars. Why? Because the upper communities of those regions felt even seeing them is something, we talk about untouchability, that is touching the people is something wrong. And even seeing them would be polluting. See, always this reservation concept had the philosophical beginning from the twin concept of purity and pollution. Some communities felt they were pure and they believed all other communities were polluting. That is why if the pure man touches the polluting man, the pure man will get polluted. And as a result of which, certain communities were not only denied admission in educational institutions. You all know that mythical example of Arjuna and Ekalvya in the story of Dronacharya. You all remember that?
Yes, sir.
Only because Ekalvya belonged to a particular community, he was denied entry in the Gurukul. Arjun actually got the training inside and he became a great warrior, a great archer. Ekalvya learned from outside, he was denied entry inside. And when Dronacharya and others were passing through the forest, they saw a young boy walking a little ahead of them. And there was a tiger which was actually creating noise from behind, sitting in the tree. This boy, Ekalvya, without turning back, he just targets with his arrow and hits at the throat of the tiger. It falls down. Dronacharya actually got perplexed. Never in all his life he had such an amount of talent, nor his disciples. Therefore, he goes to Ekalvya and asks, "Who is your master?" That Ekalvya actually kept his bow and arrow at the feet of Dronacharya and said, "Sir, you are my master." Then Dronacharya felt that I would have denied admission to this guy because he belonged to some oppressed lower class. Then immediately what struck his mind was how this guy became greater than all my disciples. What to do? Then he played cleverly. He asked him, "So did you learn from me without paying any Guru Dakshina?" That boy fell at his feet again and asked, "What shall I pay as a Guru Dakshina right now?" And unashamedly Dronacharya asked him, "You give your thumb." And the boy gave the thumb. That was the last day he played archery. Because you know that without thumb you can't play archery. This was the mythical time, which actually was historical if you read the Mandal Commission judgment. Communities were forbidden from seeing the sun. Not only untouchable, unseeable. If the upper community class people see them, they will be denied moksha. So they shall not even see them. And in Kerala, you might have heard about the Nambudris. When they get out of the house, there will be a person who will be walking 20 or 25 feet ahead of them, ringing a bell saying that Swami is coming, please get out. All have to just hide themselves because Swami shall not see anybody. If he sees, he will be denied heaven. This was the system which made all these people not only denied social status or education, but even they were not allowed to enjoy the blessings of nature. It is this oppression, this suppression which was sought to be compensated when the constitution came into being. And it proclaimed justice, social, economic and political, with the equality of status and of opportunity. How to place these two segments equally? This is so-called upper classes which for ages suppressed these classes, and these set of classes which were living in dormant even without seeing the sun, much less education. How to treat both of them equally? Only by providing some uplift, some elevator. That is what we call reservation. But when you now look at this 10% reservation, which is purely on economic basis, for whom? For the so-called suppressors, not for the suppressed. The people for age who ages for ages suppressed these masses want reservation now for themselves. This is what is actually happening. Therefore, when you talk about placing these two communities together, there comes merit. Can you ever place Arjuna and Ekalvya together? He was denied actually admission. Ekalvya was denied admission. But by his own pursuit, he actually acquired some knowledge. We can't expect that from every person. When people are prevented to come out of huts, how do you expect them to go to schools during daytime? And to our knowledge, there are no night schools available here. Thereby, if you apply this so-called merit as the only scale upon which people should be given education and employment, we are failing. We will fail in rendering social justice. That is why the constitution is very carefully worded so as to incorporate the phrase social justice, not justice on the basis of your memory tests alone. Memory also matters, but merit can't be assessed, in my view, merit can't be assessed only by marks. Otherwise, we can call that as mark merit. But what about other merits? And unequals, people who are suppressed and people who have been suppressing can't be weighed in the same balance, in equal footing. If you apply merit as alone as the criterion, then you are placing both the suppressed and the suppressor together. Therefore, reservation, no doubt, will be a little denigrating of the merit. But that is for a higher goal, that is the goal of social justice. Only when you give some relaxation in the case of the so-called merit to some oppressed communities, they can be brought up, eventually let us all be equal at one point of time. Therefore, the legal equality is different from real equality. Legal equality will place both the suppressed and the suppressor equally. But real equality will place the oppressed a little above, so that in the end of the day, they will also attain somewhat similar or equally to the oppressor or the suppressor. That is the aim of reservation here. Correct?
Yes, sir.